Good morning. Welcome to Vangen Lutheran. This Sunday, we are celebrating the day of Pentecost. Let us begin with a brief order for confession and forgiveness. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for you, and for his sake, God forgives you all your sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God and bestows on them the Holy Spirit. Amen. We will have a hymn, and it's "Breathe on Me, Breath of God." Our call to worship this morning is based on Psalm 104. Creator God, maker of earth and sky, sea and mountain, send forth your spirit and renew your people. In your goodness you provide for all living things. Send forth your spirit and renew your people. Fill us with awe and wonder, that we may delight in your handiwork. Send forth your spirit and renew your people. May all of your creation live in harmony. Send forth your spirit and renew your people. Let us pray the prayer of the day. God, our Creator, the resurrection of your Son offers life to all the peoples of earth. By your Holy Spirit, kindle in us the fire of your love, empowering our lives for service and our tongues for praise. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Our reading today is from Acts 2, verses 1 through 21. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues, as of fire, appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered, because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans?" All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" But others sneered and said, "They are filled with new wine." But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, "Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk, as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show portents in the heaven above, and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness, and the moon to blood, before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved." The end of our reading for today. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We pray that you will be with us and open our hearts to the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Consider the wind. A gentle whisper rushes leaves on the trees. A breeze lifts kites into the sky. A gale roars across an ocean, sending waves crashing against the shore. A puff of wind ignites a flame from a smoldering coal. A steady wind propels a windmill, generating power to light a house or run a water pump. Sailors make use of the wind's power to carry their boats across the lake. The wind blows unseen, yet we feel its presence and know its power. We see the wind only through what it does. We know the wind because of its effects. While we are able to use the wind's energy, we neither create it nor control it. All we can do is cooperate with it or resist it. Is it any wonder that the scriptures use the imagery of the wind to explain the power and the work of the Spirit of God? In Hebrew and Greek, the language of the scriptures, the same words can mean wind or spirit or breath, depending on how they are used. In the Gospel of John, after the resurrection, Jesus appears to his disciples and breathes on them, telling them, "Receive the Holy Spirit." Breathe on me, breath of God, fill me with life anew. Earlier in John's Gospel, Jesus had confused Nicodemus with the play on words between wind and spirit, saying, "The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes." So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. This interplay between wind, spirit, and breath stretches clear back to the beginning of the creation story in Genesis 1. The wind of the Spirit from God swept over the face of the waters, Genesis 1. We are invited to imagine the breath of God stirring waters. And I've seen pictures of that. This shared meaning can draw us more deeply into the mystery of the Holy Spirit, as we reflect on how the Spirit continues to blow through the wind, inspiring us and calling us into a clearer vision of God's love for the world. This is probably not the greatest analogy, but I like this, that when you take your glasses off, everything's blurry. And so I think this Holy Spirit is a lot like your glasses. You put them back on, and it's a clearer vision of God's love. With a sound like the rush of a mighty wind, the Holy Spirit came upon the disciples in Acts 2. Tongues of fire appeared on their heads. The divine power of wind and flame intertwined ignites the disciples' mission. As dramatic as tongues of fire on their heads may seem, the real excitement is that they are no longer bound by their own native tongues. They begin to speak in other languages, proclaiming the good news of God to the crowds who had come to Jerusalem for the festival of Pentecost. People from throughout the entire region marveled that this little group of Galileans spoke to them using their native language. Some made fun of them and dismissed it as a drunken spectacle, while others were amazed, wondering, what does this mean? Inspired by the Spirit, Peter begins to preach, his voice emerging from the commotion to explain what this means. He quotes the scriptures, drawing on the prophet Joel. "In the last days it will be," God declares, "that I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Then everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." The day of Pentecost is a new day, a new beginning. At his ascension, Jesus had told his disciples, "You will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." As the book of Acts unfolds, The Spirit-filled disciples grow into that mission. The Spirit transforms them into bold witnesses to Christ's resurrection. The Spirit inspires Peter to speak to the amazed crowd and to proclaim the good news of God's saving power. Despite hardship, opposition, imprisonment, and death, the disciples, empowered by the Spirit, carry the ministry of Jesus forward into the life of the church. They reach out with compassion to heal the sick, care for widows, provide for those who are poor or are hurting. The Spirit guides the inexperienced Christian community, forging its characteristics of generosity, mission, service, and faithfulness. The Spirit transforms the zeal of Saul, who was a persecutor of the faith. And then he turns into Paul, a tireless proclaimer of the gospel. In the baptism of the Ethiopian official, the Spirit empowers the missionary work of the church, proclaiming the gospel to those who live throughout the world. Philip is taken by the Holy Spirit to meet a highly placed Ethiopian court official who was reading the book of Isaiah on the way home from Jerusalem. And the Ethiopian asks for and receives baptism as a believer in Jesus, as God's Messiah, promised in the book of Isaiah. Another one was Cornelius, who was a Roman centurion and who is considered by Christians to be the first Gentile to convert to the faith, as related in Acts 10. The baptism of Cornelius is an important event in the history of the early Christian church. Through the conversion of Cornelius, the Spirit stretches Peter and the other believers to see that God's love includes both Gentiles as well as Jews. By the end of the book of Acts, the small gathering of disciples grows into a large community of believers stretching from Jerusalem to Rome. Even with all of our differences, ethnic origin, culture, and language, the Spirit draws us into a common experience of God's inclusive love and mercy. The Spirit is at work so that the saving news of God can be heard by all, drawing everyone into a common community. The Spirit speaks so that all can hear and understand, no matter who we are or where we come from. The gift of Pentecost is that there is room for all in God's realm. I repeat, the gift of Pentecost is that there is room for all in God's realm. The Spirit is blowing among God's people, kindling faith, breathing life into the church, inspiring and empowering us for mission. Like the wind, the Spirit itself remains hidden, unseen. Yet its works are visible through their effects. We see the Holy Spirit through what the Spirit does in and through us, in and through God's people gathered together as the church. Like the crowds on Pentecost, the Spirit can catch us by surprise, shaking us up with new expressions of God's love. The Spirit blows among God's people, stirring us to renewed vision and hope. The Spirit inspires us with the mission to proclaim the good news. The Spirit sends us forth to serve. We go in Jesus' name. Let us pray. Come, Holy Spirit, breathe into us. Set our hearts afire and empower us for lives of witness and ministry. Say our confession and with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Rejoicing in the glory of the resurrection dawn, let us pray for the church, the world, and all of God's creation. Come, Holy Spirit, and kindle the flame of gospel witness. We pray for leaders of the church and all the people of God, that together we might preach the gospel to those with needy hearts. The Spirit intercedes for us with sighs too deep for words to express. Oh, come, Holy Spirit, renew the face of the earth. We pray for oceans and sky, for rivers and deserts, for lakes and forests, for mountains and grasslands. Come, Holy Spirit, pour out justice on all the nations. We pray for countries racked with violence, for soldiers and civilians, for peacemakers and relief agencies. The Spirit intercedes for us with sighs too deep for words to express. Oh, come, Holy Spirit, give hopeful visions to the young and restful dreams to the old. We pray for those whose lives are nightmares, and for those who feel distance from your light, and for those in any need. Come, Holy Spirit, lead us in our work. We pray for firefighters and scientists, for midwives and custodians, for writers and housekeepers, for parents and students, and for so many others in our community. The Spirit intercedes for us with sighs too deep for words to express. Come, Holy Spirit, and bind us to the communion of saints who have gone before us. We remember with thanksgiving all those who served and witnessed by your power. Into your hands, O God, we commend ourselves and all for whom we pray, trusting in your abundant mercy through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. The benediction is a special benediction for Pentecost Sunday. May the Spirit of truth lead you into all truth, giving you grace to confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, and to proclaim the wonderful works of God, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you. Final hymn.
Thank you.
in peace. Christ be with you.